Now, I'm not sure where the rest of the pride is, but they have given this pair the space to complete their mating ritual, the process. Climbing into some shade. A little bit of growling, don't know why. It's not really growling, it's just groaning, grumbling. They've settled down again. I think they must be reaching the end of their mating period. Let's see if we can move a little bit. They are 6 to 8 feet off of the road and we can barely see them how long the grasses are. The male is not happy with me looking at him through the grasses. I'm not going to be able to go forward and we're not going to be able to get a better look at them. I can't go off the road to the left. It's difficult to go off road to the right. It's also very wet on the right. As you can see, we have once again these silver cluster leaf trees. Higher ground and on the lower ground above the seat line. He's not happy. try and move very slowly. And except behind the camera, he's well hidden. Fully exposed to him. Very relaxed. He won't let the female more than a few inches away from him. And she's trying to hide herself. She's trying to climb in underneath that little acacia. I can't see him. I can only hear him growling. Hi Jody. Jody's saying that when she got up and moved off, he looked back at us. Jody wants to know if I think he was warning us not to get close to his female. Yes, very much so, Jody. That was exactly what it was. And he's still warning me. He's lying behind that little tree and he's growling. A very deep, low, and I'm sure he can see me through a tiny little opening in the grasses. I can barely make him out. Just to I even have my jacket bunched. But he's calming down. As long as we sit quietly and we don't pose too much of a threat. A little bit of her hip. I can't see his ears. The best would be to see his, at least the top of his head and But if we just sit for a minute. Hello, Marlene. Do I think possibly because I'm a male that the male is giving me so much of a warning as opposed to Tara? Well, the vehicle being here than anything else. Just the proximity that we are to the lion, the way the bush is at the moment. Towards them. Sitting quietly now. He's relaxed again. Yes, I've been with these lions, and I've been on camera with Tara in the driver's seat with these same lion. Maybe not in a mating situation, but these Kajima boys are like this. They've always been like this. They've always growled at the vehicles. But the day is warm. It's not going to offer very much shade as the day wears on. Hello, Diane. Diane wants to know, what are the chances of him charging us if we start the vehicle? And are we in a dangerous position? Yes, we are slacking. We try not to get ourselves into dangerous positions. I think the biggest danger is me talking. But I keep my voice low enough. It just comes across as a monotone to them. Try not to put too much inflection in my voice. Keep it pretty low and even and steady. Chances of him charging, he could charge at any moment. And that doesn't really have anything to do with the proximity or where we are. I mean, it's something that a lion will do from 100 yards or from 10 yards. It depends on their mood. It depends on basically depends on their mood. So one has to be aware of the fact that at any moment they could charge. That would probably be a warning charge. More than anything else. Just a quick rush at the vehicle and a very heavy growl. And spitting and shouting. Because you can see the tail, you can see the ears, you can see the eyes. When they're behind the bush like this, it's difficult to assess because I can't see his body language. And that's the way dealing with any potentially dangerous animal, whether it's lion or elephant or buffalo. Watching body language, getting an idea of their state of mind. Their posture, their angle towards you, their any vocalizing. Over. Is this the Mulva that invented the pudding? Mulva wants to know what I would do if the lion. I would react very quickly, very loudly, very harshly, and I would try make myself as big as possible, which is one of the reasons why I'm sitting with my jacket on my lap, because I can because we're a big vehicle. I don't think big vehicle, I think if he's charging that would just be a warning. The fact that he hasn't already coming down and he might not charge. But the charge would be to tell us to move off, to move away if we were too close. Or if he felt we were too close. Or if he felt threatened. Pride was over here as well. They might have moved somewhere where we can see them. Take Bernie, come in. Yeah, was there only two Ngala here on Mvuga Road? Okay, copy, thanks. Only the two of them here. The rest of the pride might be up at Tambuti Dam still. Pickers. I think they're just flying over. Interesting. Jody? But he won't want to charge because, or without provocation, because he won't want to leave the female. No, I don't think so. I think line, and we would get 100 different reactions or 100 different scenarios. Guess at, or even understand, because you'd have to be in the mind of that lion. You have to be inside his head to know what he's thinking. But my guess, this is just my guess, is that if anything, he would charge to leave her or not. I mean, we've seen last night and we've seen now as well that get anywhere further than a few inches away from him. But if he got move away from her, it's a different thing. If he thought I was any threat to that female, he would charge. Where it's a threat to him or the female. And I think that the distance that we are probably to give them that space. He has stopped ground a tree, but I can't see what he's doing. And there's not much I can do about it. They're gonna move soon because it's just the nature of mating lion to become active every 20 minutes to half an hour. And see if they're going to do anything. It's a good possibility that they might sleep for the rest of the day. Had half an hour ago is covered over, it's keeping it fairly cool, otherwise they would be tucked in under shade somewhere for the rest of the day. At least this way there's a possibility they might still move around.
a bit.
Our chances of being charged have diminished considerably. I can now see a back leg sticking up in the air. So he has flopped over and gone to sleep. A giant foot in the air. Hello, Diane. Number of questions on the mating habits of lion. How many days will they mate for? Well, Diane, sometimes three, sometimes... It will last about a week sometimes. And this time, they will have to eat. Generally, it's the rest of the pride that maybe is... And then, when the mating is over, Diane wants to know, who will he leave, or will she escape, or what happens at the end, who finishes it off? Well, there's no need for her to escape, Diane. There's nowhere for her to escape to. It's not that she's not being held captive. If anything, she's held captive by her hormone. And it tends to, like now, and this might just be the end of it right now. Where she's climbed under a bush, she just wants to sleep. The way this couple is ending it. Once again, this is a behavioral thing, and there's nothing in nature when it comes write it down and say, this is what happens, because every single animal is different. Every single animal within a species is different. And every time that they're mating is different. There might be a time where she walks away, there might be a time where he leaves, there might be a time where she sneaks away, there might be a time where they're on a, it just dissipates because there's a kill from the rest of the pride. There are many different scenarios at the end of a mating period. And it's just one of those things that it's sort of, it's a wait and see. It's a wait and see type of thing. There, unfortunately, there's no way of knowing how it will end or who will end it. But generally, when she's finished ovulating, Estrus cycle is over. The pheromone scent and the scent that the actual mating behavior itself stops, but the social bonding is still there. The social bond of them being part of the same group is still there. And there's no way of knowing whether one will leave or whether they will stay together for a little while or what they up as they go along. They will decide when the time comes. I wish I could give you a better answer, or more definitive answer, but approach her now. Talking gently to her. He wants to cover her, but I don't think she's really interested much anymore. Female then. She doesn't, she's turning her back. She doesn't want his advances. Yeah, snapping at him. And don't take it out on me, boy, because she doesn't want you. Yes, looking at me and growling. I think this is the end of the mating. You know, very, very often the female is the one that elicits the copulation, where she will get up and she will rub against him, and she will display in front of him and actually crouch in front of him to invite him. And ever since last night, he's the one that's been initiating it, and she's tolerated it. Yesterday she was tolerating it, but now it looks like she's not tolerating it anymore. She must be quite sore by now. And I'm sure probably that is maybe the end. Could have been that this buffalo that they killed was right in the middle of this mating cycle, and that they were mating prior to this, and they've been going at it for a few days. But just from that little bit of behavior that we've just seen, it looks like she's not interested anymore. In fact, I very, very seldom have seen the male trying to initiate copulation. Not often. Now, not every copulation is their penetration, and not every copulation is their fertilization, and that's one of the reasons why there are these multiple matings that take place over several days. Cats again. Look at that. But as you can see, you can barely see a thing. They are a couple of feet off the road. And if you were walking along this road right now, they would probably only jump up when you came. Within striking distance. And it's under those circumstances where an animal will adopt the concept of attack as the best form of defense. If you're walking along the road and you're still 50 yards away and you managed, and you were talking and making a bit of when these times are, because everything is always ahead of you. And that is why it's not advisable for anybody to go walking through the bushveld unless you know what you're doing. Signals around us to tell us that there are lions here. There are no birds alarming at them. There are no animals shouting. So if one was on foot, you would never know that there were a pair of lions just of you. Exploding out of the long grasses, spitting fire and fury. There's no bungee jumping or roller coaster or anything else, or even any drug on the market for that matter, that can get the adrenaline going and put one on such a high as being in that situation of disturbing lion unexpectedly and getting that really gruff growl, grumble, rumble combination of all, including a spitting and snarling when you bump into lion on foot. No, that's wrong. Not almost addictive. It is addictive. That's nature for you. Nature is so wonderful. You don't need a lion to have an ultimate adrenaline rush. Maybe tracking lion on foot can work just as well. leave them be. They're sleeping. There's not going to be much that we're going to see them do. I'm going to try and sneak forward and get back onto the road ahead of them. There's a good chance that they will be around for this afternoon, for later. Tara will be on drive later. And then we'll see, Marlene. We'll see if mind whether they react differently to Tara. But generally, I think it's the vehicle that they react to more than anything else. So, see if we can sneak past them. Yeah, the sun's coming out again. Way up towards Kari Dam. I think in the last hour, last few minutes of the drive. Okay.